Wait.
All right, so Erev Tov, good evening, everybody. Welcome to our talk about how to hack the Israeli culture. As you know, Israelis love to hack things, especially technology, so we thought it was really appropriate to call this How to Hack Israeli Culture. My name is Tamar. I am the founder of Citizen Cafe. If you all don't know it, then basically what we're really about is trying to change the immersion process of internationals in Israel, making it more fun, accessible, smooth. And the big thing that we've got going right now is our Ulpan. We teach Hebrew differently. If you're interested in finding more, you can talk to me later. So just to clarify a little bit, I am Israeli. I am also Australian. I was born to Australian-Israeli parents. My accent will change every minute, and I do apologize because I grew up in the States, actually New Jersey, Detroit, San Francisco, New Zealand, and Sydney, and I moved to London, to Paris, and I have a serious identity crisis. And my accent might change. I don't actually control it, so I apologize in advance. I always say that. You could probably say that it's not surprising that I do what I do today, and I work with a lot of internationals about what it means to immerse themselves into the Israeli culture and try and adapt easier, because I've kind of been hacking culture since the day I was born, because I did move about 18 times. And I guess I was always thrown into these situations until I tried to figure out what was this equation that you have to do in order to go into a culture that's totally new and just kind of figure out how it's done. So this is kind of what we're going to talk about today. And I guess the goal for us, or for me, then in the next hour, you guys have a lot of questions, probably, that I hopefully will be able to answer some of them, or give you some skills, tools, that when you reach situations which are not familiar, because not all Israelis fit into everything he's going to speak about, you'll have a little bit more of a tool set to deal with them. So the goal for today is really to try and give you guys a little bit more clarity about daily interactions that you have in your life here, whether you're working and you have teammates and colleagues that are Israelis, whether you're trying to get a job and going for interviews, whether you're trying to date Israelis, and God knows that's not simple. Okay, I guess that's a topic for you. And so we're really going to touch upon those things and keep the questions that you have. If you feel like you haven't answered them, then raise your hand later. You can even stop in the middle. I don't care. I usually do this in workshops. So this is a talk, but guys, if you feel like something's kind of coming up and you don't want to wait, that's okay. Raise your hand. And if not, we'll do a little bit of questions later that we can go through if you wanted to. So I'll leave you feeling not only more in control, a little bit more knowledgeable, hopefully a little bit more inspired to kind of create the life that you want here in Israel. How does that sound? Okay. So going back a little bit, just to give you a bit of a context about me, I pretty much moved around providing services all my life. I had concierge companies, if you guys know what that is. It's providing a lot of people services, and usually I was working with very high net worth individuals. This meant that I was constantly trying to understand what people wanted. And then I ended up opening a couple concierge companies here in Israel and dealt with a lot of internationals moving here and struggling trying to, bring whether they're wealth and trying to figure out what Israelis are all about. And I ended up coaching a lot of them. But what really, really brought me to dealing with this topic was actually a secret that I don't say very often, is that I didn't want to live in Israel most of my life. I am Israeli. And I did the army and I did my high school here because I always wanted to be in the big world. It always mattered more. And so I did live in the big world until I lived in London about 9 years ago, and I was really tired of dealing with a lot of wealthy people. I was kind of soulless. And then I just ran across the story of Gilad Shalit. I don't know any of you guys know Gilad Shalit. He was in captivity by Hamas for about 5.5 years. It turned into my life project. So over 5 years, I ended up doing not only a big event in London for them, I documented his family, made a movie about his family, and I traveled the world a lot with that movie, telling the story of Israel. I didn't realize what I was doing at the time. I was just saying, guys, this is kid, and we have to get him out. And then he came back, and I made a movie with him about him, which is the only documentation with Gilad until today. But what I didn't realize that I was becoming so immersed in what I couldn't understand how a whole country was obsessed for 5 years about one soldier that was in captivity, something hostages are all over the world, different countries, we all know. And I couldn't understand why they couldn't get him out. I mean, discussions of releasing 1,000 prisoners, and a whole nation, a whole culture felt this kid was theirs. And that was really special. Without noticing, I started talking about the Israeli culture around the world. And this is really what brings us back to today. What is it about the Israeli culture that sometimes is so different to what you guys know from back home? And how can you use it to your advantage to try and create the life that you want here, with all the differences? So we kind of did a bit of a round before. It's really interesting to see the diversity of people here, and I love that. And I always excite me when people from all over the world come here to Tel Aviv. I just want you to take a minute, even turn to the person next to you, and just like take 30 seconds, 20 seconds, tell them what you love the most about Tel Aviv. Because before we go into this, we need to remember why we're here. So like take 20 seconds. Tell the person next to you why you love Tel Aviv, what excites you about Tel Aviv. So let's dive into things a little bit, and I'm sure that you will all agree with me that we all on a rational level know that we're really different. So we realize that if we come from a certain place and then we move to a different place, things are going to be different. And we just accept it. You realize that if you're coming from Finland and you come to Israel, it's going to be different. But is accepting the fact that it's different enough to live the life that you want? What do you think?
Can you repeat the question?
Is it enough to just accept that it's different? Like you're compassionate, you're like, the Israelis are different. So I want to touch in order to answer that, a word that we don't tend to think about too much, and it's stereotypes, because we usually think that stereotypes are something negative. But interestingly enough, stereotypes are something that we quite often use in a positive way. But let's touch them for a second. I usually do this in workshops, it makes it a bit easier if I just sum it up. I ask quite often, like, what is a stereotypical American like? And I had a workshop, you can hear the giggles. I had a workshop just like 3 days ago, I don't know if anybody was in this workshop, and they all said loud, obnoxious, fat, and they were Americans. Really? And I was like, really? But I know a lot of Americans, I'm sure you guys do, and there's some Americans here, they're not at all like that, but you kind of get why they said it, right? And we all can think about the stereotypical French, but not all French are like that. I'm a big Parisian girl. So, interestingly enough, stereotypes are actually something that are positive in the sense that when we come to something new that we don't know how to translate, it can actually serve us, because then we can say, well, you know, Israelis do that. I mean, I come from London, I'm not used to people just screaming in the street and hugging each other, which is what Israelis do all the time, right? It's like, Israelis do that. And we go, okay, cool, we get it. We can accept it, Israelis do that. And then we do it again, and then something happens in the bank, and they're like screaming at each other, and like, okay, no, Israelis do that. And they cut the line, Israelis do that. But then what happens when all we have to cling on are stereotypes? It's like, no matter what happens during the day, like, Israelis do that, I don't know, but Israelis do that, I'm all understanding. And then we grow the gap. The more we accept it and don't have anything else to understand, basically we're just attaching ourselves to the Israeli culture, from whatever culture we're doing it to, because we're not connecting, we're just accepting all the time. And then we accept it, and then we start excusing it, oh, because they do that, then, I just have to deal with it. And then you're dating an Israeli, and his family does this, and you're like, yeah, but you know, it's his family. And then you're starting to maybe sacrifice some of your values, or compromising things you don't want to, because you're trying to be accepting, because that's what Israelis do. Sound familiar a little bit? So this is where stereotypes, where they're not used right, or just overused, actually become a negative and detach us a little bit too much from what we're trying to do. So what we want to do is be able to look at the Israeli culture and the system and not feel so detached from them. So this is the thing. You can live in a bubble. I know a lot of rich people live in a bubble. A lot of Americans that live in a bubble, you don't even need Hebrew, and I have a Hebrew school. But then when you walk out the street every morning, you have to go to the bank, you have to go to the supermarket, and you're trying to get a job, even if it's all English speakers, there are Israelis around, and you're dealing with reality. So what I'm saying today is let's dive into it, not just accept that things are different, let's embrace Israeli culture, let's try and understand what really goes on in their mind. So if you wanted to, at certain situations, you could just go into how Israelis see the world. At times you'll say, it's not for me. At times you'll say, I just accept it. And at times you'll go, I'm going to really take it on. Because I can gain from it, I can develop, I can grow, I can change. It's up to you. I want you guys to have control over those things today. So, I'm going to start by a little question. If I was going to, we'll stick with the American culture. An American CEO tomorrow for an interview. And I was asking you guys, can you give me like the three top tips that I need to have down so I nail this job interview? The American CEO, super important director. What do you think?
Good handshake.
Good handshake, cool.
Dress properly.
Dress properly.
Know the business.
Know the business.
Ask questions.
Ask questions. What about small talk? What? No small talk, you're saying? Okay, and the answers seem to be, no matter how often I do these workshops, the answers are always the same. You gotta dress right. Coming on time is not enough. Come early, that's coming on time. Small talk can be on weather or sports. Never ask them personal questions. And children, God forbid, you never ask someone like that, right? But do you think that if we ask the same question about an Israeli CEO, if you're going to interview, would the answers be the same? And clearly not, but what would they be, and not just sticking to a cliche, because he's a human being, and obviously he's just not a walking stereotype. So how can we approach these situations? So I want to dive into it like this. See, cultures are like people. And what's interesting about people, that we are all individuals, but at the same time, we all seem to do things differently. Because we all have this inner hierarchy of values, which is different to each person. So I think you would all agree that we all want to be beautiful, we all want to be loved, we all want to be successful, and we all want to be healthy, right? So who here wants to be healthy? Everybody. Who here goes to the gym every single day, doesn't eat fried food, probably gets their blood checked every 3 months, I don't know. Who does that every single day? Not everybody. But you all want to be healthy, right? But some people do more and some people do less, and I can ask the same questions about how many of you want to be beautiful, but how many of you actually go and get your hair done every single day? Some do, some don't. So why does that differ? And it turns out that people have this inner value system, but for some reason, it's how they believe they need to survive what's going to serve them. And some people believe that looking better is going to help them more to survive in our culture or in our daily life, in our to attract what we want to our lives. And cultures are exactly the same. See, interestingly enough, if we look at all the cultures, I'm sure you would all agree with me, that all the cultures want to thrive, they want to grow, they want to develop, they want to be successful, right? But they don't all behave the same. And when I say cultures in this essence, it's a group of people, and all individuals, and they're all different. But what's interesting about cultures is something that unites them, which is a history, education, all these things. So when, again, when we talk today about people in different cultures, it's not individuals that we meet. It's something general that they were brought up with that's above them, and this is what they know intuitively. So, what is it about the different cultures that's different? And I'm going to give you an example. Let's take the British culture. Who we said here, who's from London here, there's a few people. So I want you to imagine that there is a lens, glasses, that you are not aware that you're wearing, that are actually your cultural lens to the world, the way your culture, where you came from, see the world. And I want you to take them off, and we're going to put on the glasses of a British culture. And the British culture, in its essence of how to survive, actually imagine there's like a book of rules. If you do this, you'll succeed. There's like a way to do things in the British culture. There's a way to greet somebody, even if you don't mean it. This is what quite often upsets people about the British people. There's a way to succeed. There's a way to get a promotion. Do that. And that's how they see the world. This is why there's such a proper culture. Let's take the American culture. Let's put on the glasses of the American culture. I'm sure you'd all agree with me that one of the most important things for the American cultures to survive is actually not just doing the right thing, but being the best. It's a very competitive culture. Something in their essence believes that competition is more important than everything. Being the best, being second is like being dead. It's like you gotta be number one, Ivy League schools, all those things. It doesn't mean that every single American feels that, but they all understand. They're running there, they're going, yeah, there's something that we kind of were brought up with, we never could put their finger on it, but it's true. And even for the example, I'll take a really extreme different example of the Indian culture. They all want to succeed, they all want to grow, they want to be the best, they want to do the right thing. But interestingly enough, especially Israelis, we love to go to India because there's some sort of serenity and happiness that the Indian culture perceives as the most important thing to survive. You know those really poor people in India with no legs, like no teeth, and he's smiling? It's because they were brought up thinking that, you know, serenity or peace is something that's really important. This is why they're great at being peaceful. So they all want the same thing, but for some reason, in their hierarchy, to survive, they need different things. So where does that bring us? To the Israeli culture. And what do you think will happen if I take your glasses off from whatever culture you come from and we put the Israeli glasses on? What are we gonna see? We're gonna see a book of rules, we're gonna see competition.
Chaos.
Chaos? So, not far from it, I like to say that the Israelis see a jungle. And this is one of the key things that I want you to try and understand. And clearly they don't see lions and elephants and giraffes. So it's a bit of a cynical approach, but I want you to be with me. So when Israelis look at the world, whether they know it or not, and I do not suggest to go to an Israeli and ask them, hey, do you see a jungle when you wake up in the morning? They'll be like, I mean, you're crazy. Because they're not aware of it. But what is the jungle? What are the principles of the jungle? And this might give you some insight in a lot of situations that have happened to you. Because in the jungle, it's about being, not being the best. It's about being the strongest. And it's very black and white. Because if you're not strong, you're weak, and if you're weak, you're down. It's black and white. And there's an element that will guide Israelis all the time. Because in the jungle, there are always two camps. There's my camp, my hood, my tribe, and them, the enemy. There's no middle ground. You don't see the lion going to the deer and going, hey, sweetie, you take that part, I'll take that part. It's like to the death. And it's about strength. And weaknesses is perceived as something that won't let you survive. And they can't control it, they can't help it. This is where a lot of aggression might come from. So when you realize that there's all these principles in the jungle, then you realize that Israelis not only feel the world differently, there's actually a way to access them that you might have not had till now, which I'm going to try and help you understand. And who knows what this word is? Who doesn't know what this word is? Okay, friar. If all you take from today is this word, then I've done my job. Because this word describes Israeli culture, unfortunately. It means a sucker, to be a sucker, to be screwed over at times. This word guides Israelis every single day. It's an obsession not to be a friar. All they'll be asking is, do I look like a friar? I'm going to be a friar. If he was a friar, if he wasn't the friar, I'm probably the friar. It's actually such a national obsession that even you'll see it on billboards about only friars vote Netanyahu, for example. You'll see it in duty free ads, you'll see it on mobile phone, the biggest mobile phone company. Their biggest slogan was, don't be a friar, stop paying so much. It's an obsession. Because in their mind, someone's always going to screw you over. In order to explain it to you guys, I want you to imagine a mantra that goes on in Israelis' minds that they're not aware of. Again, I wouldn't ask them if they have that mantra in their head. Everything you get is something I lose. Now try and understand what I mean. Every spoon that you eat is a spoon that I didn't eat. Every dollar that you take in this deal is a dollar that's not in my pocket. That's all they seem to see. That's just how it works. And so when you think about things like even negotiation and business, a lot of cultures, it's very acceptable when you make deals. It's about a win-win situation. You know, it is like Asian countries, in America it's very popular, in Europe. See, in Israel, win-win just doesn't feel right, because whatever you got, I didn't get. A win-lose is the ultimate situation for an Israeli, whether they know it or not. Okay. So when you have that on board, and we'll go deeper into how we can do that later, you can actually make an Israeli feel that he's got a great deal, if he just got everything out of you, if you're happy about it, if you control the situation, great. This is how you'll get them thinking that it's a good deal. So, it's a tribal community. And remember the two camps. And what we're going to try and work on is how can you possibly be on their camp. Okay. So, I'm going to give you like a theoretical, also quite a simple situation. I want you to imagine there's like a bowl of soup, and there's three really hungry British people. Swiss people. We're at the Swiss, so there's Swiss people. And they had to find a way to split the soup. What's going to happen? What will they do it? With a cultural adaptation to it, obviously not an individual one. Clearly, they'd probably split like a third, a third, a third, because that's what you do, and that's how it's done. There's not too many questions to be asked. Okay. But what would happen if I told you a funny scenario of three hungry Israelis, and there's one bowl of soup? What's going to happen? What do you think? Fight? Okay, what do you think?
First one?
First one's gone. First one's okay. So there's like endless scenarios. We don't really know, and we're not trying to mock the Israelis. But the idea is that the scenarios can be on two extremes, actually. Yeah, they could probably split it equally, potentially. Yes, they could kill to the death and eat, you know, one would eat all. But if an Israeli will sense that you are in his camp, someone that he feels that he needs to take care of you, you might actually get his portion of the soup. He might actually give it to you. And this sometimes explains the extreme feeling or situations that so many internationals tell me. It's like they either hate me or love me. I like bumped into someone on the street and they took me to their house and I had dinner and like they took care of me. Or they shut. It's because Israelis have this kind of like coding system. It's like we always laugh at it. Two questions on the first date when Israelis go out. They need to know what you did in the army and where they're from, and they can smell each other. It's all happens in the jungle. It's all like intuition. And they know everything. It's like, okay, I can take you home to my parents or I can't. It's that kind of animal instinct that doesn't exist in all other cultures. That's, Israelis don't always show it. They don't even realize it, but they do it. And the challenge when you're not Israeli, or not a native Israeli, is that they don't know how to figure you out. They can't understand, is she in my camp? I don't know. They can't read you, and they're not comfortable. What you need to be able to do is to make sure that they understand that you're with them. Does that ring a little bit of a bell when you think about how Israelis behave a little bit in extreme situations? So another thing that I want to go over is rules. So in your countries, I suppose especially in Switzerland, we can take that extreme example, rules are rules. You are not late. Very often, you know, you just don't cancel on people, inappropriate. Probably book in advance, right? When you think about, like, I don't know, Finland, you book things in advance, you just want to be correct with people.
Well, I don't.
You don't, good. Maybe that's where you're Israel. So what do you guys think Israeli culture perceives rules as?
Suggestions.
It's amazing how it's the first answer. Suggestions, what?
Restrictions.
Restrictions, okay. Anything else?
Negotiable.
Negotiable, cool. Yeah?
A chat.
A chat, okay.
Actually, no, Israelis are very, very bureaucratic, and it's like bureaucracies all the time, everywhere, and there are the hogs, and I think actually they follow rules much more than
like the whole point is to know somebody and get some protection, yeah, we'll get you around it.
No, but I mean on like everyday situations, like,
right,
why give him some of this piece of paper, and no, you have to take the paycheck.
The bureaucracy exists everywhere because it's not good, it's not built well. It exists not because it's there are rules so much, might mean.
No, but like I mean, obviously, no, she cannot take this piece of paper from you, you have to take the paper, the number, because it's against the law.
So what would happen if you put like a book of rules, a book, in the jungle? It's really hard to survive. What works there? It's instinct, it's intuition, it's spontaneity, it's that that makes people survive quite often. You agree with me? And you're right, in Israel, Israelis still know what to do with rules. They think they want them, but they love to break them. So I want you to think about the next mantra. I'm trying to understand why Israelis don't like rules so much, because they kind of have in their head a sentence going like this: well, why play by the rules if others don't? So you know that whole thing of standing in line. So it's kind of annoying to stand in line when everyone else is taking over, right? So it's like you start also mimicking each other. Well, if they're overtaking, I'm going to do it, and then it just becomes an endless game because I'm actually doing it and I'm going to do it. But even more so, why play by the rules if there's a faster way I can get it? That also happens in the raw jungle. If there's a fast way, you get it, otherwise you die. And if, you know, if there's a space here, I'm not sure you're standing in line, well, you know what, there's faster, I'm just gonna go like this. And this is what Israelis do. They just excuse you by that, they feel comfortable, they're just like, you're just moving forward, you're just stopping me because you're not even standing in line properly. So Israelis think like that. They're like constantly trying to figure out how they can get things faster, protect it, which is what someone threw in here. It means to know somebody and get a favor. You can't get anywhere in the army, hardly, if you don't know somebody, you want to get into like a reunion. All these things are very well known in the country because this is what happens in very tribal countries. Everybody knows everybody. So the reason this protective concept of having to know somebody who will get you in is because it's somebody calling somebody, basically saying, hey, you know that person? Let me make it clear for you, they're in our camp. And they go, oh, okay, I'll take them on board. And Israeli will always prefer to hire somebody or to get to know somebody that is familiar to them, but also serves their purpose of being strong. So, what does that mean for you guys? Because it's very frustrating when you don't think the same way, and then a lot of Israeli behavior frustrates people. But in actual sense, this is a massive place of opportunity. Because it means that you can do things totally different from where you came from, because Israel is all about opportunity. There's a great German CEO who always says that in Israeli culture, German culture, failure is failure. But in Israel, failure is always opportunity. But it reflects on everything. So let's take the example we said about rules and not being late in other cultures. If you think about how Israelis see the world, let me tell you a few things that you can take from this and definitely go with the flow with it. And it can start from being spontaneous. So I know when I used to live in London, I had to book things in advance, quite even coffee with people,
yeah.
Right? And if you cancel them, God forbid, that's it. You're out for like 5 months until they forgive you.
Yeah.
And never be late, ever. So just, you don't do that, right? So in Israel, first of all, yeah, you can be late and let go. But think about it this way. If I invite you for coffee in 3 weeks, let me tell you, when I see you in 3 weeks, I might not be as excited to see you as I am right now when I'm calling you up. But imagine I'm calling up, I'm like, yeah, let's have a coffee in 20 minutes. When I see you, trust me, we're going to have a great time because I really feel like seeing you. Because it's that impulsive urge, and we follow it.
Yes, and I want to add that it's just living the present moment.
Living the present moment. So, spontaneity is great. The fact that you can just call people, I don't know how you guys do with dating here, but it is not considered so offensive for somebody to SMS you at 10:30 at night and go, well, do you want to go out for a drink in an hour? Maybe younger ages, like, you know, 25, but it happens, and it's not rude, it's not necessarily a booty call either. It just means, I feel like seeing you right now, I'm going to do it right now because this is just how, you know, this is my urge. And this is the bright side of Israelis. You can tell them you don't want that or you don't like it, but don't necessarily be offended because this is just how they see the world. So another thing is you can just be informal, not just spontaneous. So when you go to work, you can dress casually. When you wear a suit, you probably look like the odd person out. We can always tell tourists on the street when they're wearing the suit and tie, but nobody wears ties here no matter what you've done at work and what title you have. You can express your opinion no matter what hierarchy goes on in your company. You can walk up to the founder of your startup and tell them whatever you want because they'll respect you if you do. You're showing strength and you're showing you're on their account and the equation works. I'm like, okay, I like you. They'll respect you. And there's a familiarity. So people have, you know, I grew up in New Jersey. I remember it was like Mrs. Hollinger, I think her name was. I couldn't even imagine knowing her first name. Nobody can imagine knowing their last name here for your teachers. It's just all about like Hana, Ghana, whatever it is. It's informal. This is how our children grow up with. They don't even understand what formality in that sense is. And it comes into anything. This is why we're going to job interviews. It might also explain a little bit why small talk really works. If you come into a CEO or whatever director you're going for an interview and all you're doing is just reading your lines, what are they doing? They're like, okay, I cannot figure out what this person is going to, what is he going to gain me? What is he going to bring? Is he going to be daring? Is he on my camp or not? Is he going to be strong or weak? But when you start small talking to them, something happens. You make a connection and you slowly shift. And this is what you want to do. So informality is a great tool. And like I said, with dating, it can be direct, impulsive. An Israeli guy, and I'm not saying all do, just come up to a girl and go, you're going to go out with me. And I'm not saying other people in other cultures can't do that, but just don't be surprised when Israelis do that because they just think that that's how it works. They want to show you, it's like a thin gesture of love. I want you right now. It's very, you know, very, very similar to maybe Latin cultures in that sense. Because Israelis dare. And this is what I want you to really take with you. So the more you dare here, the more they'll respect you. The more you dare to be who you are, the more they'll understand you. The more you can connect with them, the more you can connect with them, the more they'll see you on their side. And then the more you can get from them. So there's something, a lovely woman called Osnat Lauman, who works a lot with Israeli cultures, international cultures, actually broke down, I love it, how the Israelis are. And the I was very formal and straightforward and risk-taking and ambitious and entrepreneurial and loud and improvisational. And I think this sums up Israelis really, really well. You can always remember that. So this is the thing. I want you to remember that the Israeli culture is not only a tribal culture. We're in the Middle East. We're Western. We're primitive and then we're modern at the same time. We're a very, very complex culture. And I'm going to give you a little secret about the Israeli culture. You know how many of you have Israelis approaching them and saying, oh, really, you're from like LA? And like, what are you doing here if you can be in LA? How many times a day does this happen to you? A lot. From Sydney, right? A lot? You know what I mean? Like, really? Why are you here? And it gets annoying. I always get told that. It's like, so annoying. Why do they keep asking me? So here's the thing. Israelis ask you, what are you doing here? Why are you not back home? Because they really, 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 really don't understand. Why the hell would you be here when you can be there? Because for them, it's there. And it always has been. Doesn't matter how modern or growing, there's a massive sense of insecurity that Israelis don't realize that they have, but they very much carry with them. It comes from a lot of things, and we can break it down for hours. But remember, the Israeli culture in many ways, this is a very sensitive thing to say, is quite an abused culture. It's a small culture, it's like a little kid, very abused, physically abused. There's a lot of things that physically happen to us. People attack us. Not even saying who's at fault, it's not a political issue. And emotionally abused. So much of the world hates us, doesn't get us. Constantly just trying to survive, trying to just stay sane, not only successful. Look at what they did here for just an odd 70 years. Quite incredible. So when you realize that they're insecure, it means that when you come in and you've done all these great things from around the world, and you're standing right over there and they're over here, they don't sometimes know how to take it in. It's like, well, if you were so successful in Finland, well, what are you doing here in our little country, in our little tribe? Maybe you're not good. A lot of people that try to get work or even volunteer, they've done great stuff. I have a friend, she was amazing in London in the police. And she came here, she said, I just want to volunteer. She called the police and they hung up the phone on her. She said, but I'm like really serious person in London, and all I want to do is give my time for free. And I said to her, well, because that's the problem. You said, I'm from London, and I do all these great things, and I'll work for free. So what was the Israeli way of translating it? Well, she's not worth much. She's not going to help me. She's going to take me down. I can't even sense her. I don't know what she wants. Not good for me. There's a lot of ways she could approach it, but there was not enough of the connection for her to go, the reason I'm here is this. I can earn whatever thousands of pounds over there. The reason I'm giving this up is for this. And I'm going to give you guys a chance to try me out. And you know what? I want to do this. And if I succeed, then I'd like to get paid. There was no dialogue about her worth and her strength and the fact that she wants to be in their camp. She just assumed they'll take the information and go, okay, well, come help us. Well, Israelis don't know what to do with that. And I hear a lot of these kind of situations. So I want to leave you with 5 tips that you can take with you to try and sum everything up. And the first one is to accept, because we touched that in the beginning and said, well, accepting is not so great. Well, let me give you a great example of what I think accepting is. I have a great friend from London, actually. He's done very well, moved to Israel, gave up a lot to move here. And then he said to me, after living here for like 15 years, he goes, you know what? I can't really avoid being a friar because this is the Israeli culture, I get it. And so I thought about a solution of how I can accept the fact that I can never trick the Israeli culture from never being a friar. I'm going to accept it. And he called it the friar budget. So he decided to put aside $500 a year. And he said, I just know I'm going to get screwed up at some point. Some taxi driver is going to take extra. And I'm not going to get upset about it because I live here now. I don't live in London. Anything about $500 is going to get me really cheap. And I think that's a great example of how you just accept where you are, but not cross your red lines. So accept it, live it, embrace it to the point where it's comfortable for you. The next thing is, don't take it personally. Now, this is a really big sentence, and it might not seem like that, because I got so many people calling me crying and that, and they screamed at me when I went to the mobile company, and I'm like, don't take it personally. It's just the way things are done here. Quite often, she's chewing the chewing gum and blowing the bubbles in front of you because that's just what she does. It's not because of you. Don't take it personally. These things happen. It's just different. You mustn't. But at the same time, let me give you my third tip. Don't take it personally, but always make it personal. Because remember, if you want to connect to Israelis, if you want to get something from them, which is could be getting to know them, working with them, you always want to be on their side. And making it personal, I'll give you a great example. I know somebody who used to go to the market all the time, and she'd tell me, this guy keeps ripping me off. He knows I'm international. He knows I'm not, you know, I don't speak Hebrew, and he keeps charging me more than others, I'm pretty sure. And then one day, he came with a shirt that had Chelsea on it. And the guy got so excited. The guy was selling the fruit and vegetables because he went to a game once and he loved Chelsea. And they had this great conversation, they bonded, and you know what? He walked out with a whole bag of free avocados. Because that's the way Israelis work. It's either there or here. And it's kind of a tool for you to understand that you can be an either. So if you've got somebody coming to do work for you, a professional, they'll see, international, doesn't know Israeli prices, I might just call my next fryer. Or have a conversation with them, talk to them, try and connect them, try and figure out what you guys have in common, maybe not. And if he starts caring for you, this will probably get him to feel very differently about you. And I've had situations, I've heard a lot of stories, that even an electrician that, you know, came in, he ended up fixing up all their lights for free because, like, oh, you seem to need help because you're new here, and that person was very confused. Because not only they want you to be strong in their camp, if you are weak or struggling or lost with directions, you know this on the street, I get told a lot of these stories, and then somebody just takes you. You know, if you're in my camp and you're weak, I have to protect you. This way, Israelis feel really protective. There's also no boundaries between Israelis. You know, they just walk up to anybody and tell them, you know, comment, yeah, you keep doing this. Because it's like, if you're in my camp, you're like my cousin. I have to tell you the bad things, the good things. I'll scream at you, I'll hug you. That's how it works. So as long as you can get there, you can get them. And the last thing is really, sorry, it's the fourth thing, I'm sorry. Be knowledgeable. And when I say be knowledgeable is that you know that things might be different back home. So find out information if you're going to events, if it's casual, if it's not. Don't always feel like you're not sure what's happening, just ask people. But more than that, know that Israelis are not really great organizers. You know, I always give the example when you go to mobile phone companies, you're trying to get things done, that's a real jungle. Like, that's literally lions and they're all animals there. And they're trained to deal with Israelis. And just so you know, their training is about how to deal with aggression. So this is how an Israeli would come into a mobile phone, like an Orange, and start screaming. The first thing, they start screaming and demanding, thinking that this is what's gonna get them something, they're strong, and this is what they're trained for. But guess what? They're not really trained in how to deal with people who come in very elegantly and make a really good claim. And when I say really good claim is come prepared. Do what Israelis actually don't do. They get confused by it, and I know somebody who got a brand new phone, which I've never heard an Israeli get a brand new phone as a gift from because you just sat there persistent, very elegant. And I said, you know what, we've never dealt with somebody like you. We don't even know what to do with you. It's just everything's so perfectly organized and all the facts, and you know what, here's a phone. We don't know what to do. So be knowledgeable, keep track. It's actually what Israelis don't do very well because they're just used to, well, I won't work it out. I'll just scream on the phone and then I'll argue and I'll get something. And now it's not always that useful. And the last thing, and this is really important, is be authentic. And when I say be authentic is because imagine Israelis have this like radar here in the back of their neck. They can't stand something that's not authentic. It's sometimes annoying because they can be so authentic and rude. They don't like something and they want to say something, but they appreciate authenticity. They appreciate directness. Even if you're on a date, tell that person what you don't like. It's okay, they'll probably treat you even better. And what Israelis quite often find frustrating about other cultures is that they're not authentic. They're like, just keep asking me, smiling how I am, and I don't think they need it, and I don't know what to do. And it's quite frustrating because I'm just used to feeling things, right? Because they're more animal-like in that sense. So Israelis really, really respect that. And remember, the Israeli culture is an odd one. You walk down the street and it's mixed and it's complicated. It's tense. So this is my last thing to you. Israelis are often insecure. They don't always know how to deal with people who aren't Israeli. They get excited at the same time, they're a bit distant. You might not know how to interact with them all the time. Let me tell you something. When you guys are here and you tell them that you want to be here because you believe in Israel, you guys are really inspiring Israelis again. Because it's not an easy time for any country in the world maybe today, but it's certainly an easy time for us. And I know many, many Israelis who try to live overseas and then come back. And the reason I do this is because you guys that are trying to live here or living here or would like to live here hold a strength that Israelis sometimes forget that they have, a belief in Israel that we just take as a given. So your energies and whatever you bring to Israelis, you'll be surprised if you do it right, if you come into their team and you offer it, you're really strengthening Israel. I really believe your community is being one of the key tools to get Israel to continue thriving and growing, to teach Israelis things that they're not that great at, and I think they're being more and more open to it right now. And you really do inspire Israelis, even if they don't show it. They really can't believe you're here, and when you stick to Israel, they keep going, wow, you know what? Maybe we do have a great country. And you have that power to do that. So taking all that, who has some questions?